Hey everyone, Josh Powers here with Quixel, and in today's video, I'd like to show you how we can retexture numerous Megascans assets with just a single smart material. So let's jump right in. Alright, now that we're in Mixer, I can go ahead and load a 3D model from the Megascans library. So to do that, I'm just going to go up to the Setup tab here, and then I'm going to change the type from Plane to 3D Asset. And this is going to load all the 3D assets from the Megascans library that I've downloaded locally. For this tutorial, I'll select this Roman gravestone asset right here. Alright, now that that's loaded, I'm ready to start texturing. So to do that, I'm going to go back to the Layers tab and then click the Add Surface Layer icon right here. I'll type in concrete in the search bar and then choose this concrete smooth surface for my first layer. Okay, there's not a whole lot of changes I'm going to make for this surface. I do want to give it a name to keep things organized, but all the blend and placement settings I'm going to leave alone. However, I am going to give the albedo a more brownish tan look to it by punching in a hex value that I wrote down earlier. And that's about it for this base layer. So what I'm going to do now is go up and make sure that the layer is selected, and then I'm going to hit Ctrl D, and that's going to duplicate the layer for me. I'll give it a descriptive name, and then the first thing I want to do is give it a brighter albedo value for some staining. I don't want it to be too overpowering, so I'll pull down the opacity quite a bit to keep the effect pretty subtle. And then I'll change the angle of the box projection to give the details of the texture a little bit of an offset from the base layer below. Alright, now we need a mask so that we don't have the entire layer showing through. So I'm going to go ahead and go down to the bottom of the layer stack and click on the mask stack icon. And the first component I'm going to add is a purlin noise. If I hit 9 on the keyboard, I can go into mask view, and as I adjust the seed slider, you can see that it's just giving me random values for this particular noise. So I'll go ahead and just set this to 37. And for the amplitude, the higher the value, the more we see those darker grays go to black and the lighter values to white. So it's kind of like playing with the contrast. So I'm going to pump this value all the way up to 10 to give me a really strong contrast for this noise. And then the frequency as it sounds means the higher I push this number, the smaller the pattern looks. And then the lower I adjust it, the larger the pattern becomes. I'm also going to go ahead and set this to around 10 as well. Increasing the octaves will take the falloff or gradient of that noise and start to add some grungier looking transitions so that it's not something smooth like this. So as we bump it up, it'll feel a bit noisier and natural and less of a procedural feel to it. Okay, I'm going to leave the lacunarity and persistence alone right now, and then I'm going to go ahead and go up to the modifier button and add a projection modifier. And if I change this from tiling to box projection, I can grab this handle and spin it around, and it'll change the projection angle of our map. So I'll spin this to around 168 degrees, and then I'll also adjust the tilt of the box projection to further fine-tune the results. We can use the radius slider to tweak the blend sharpness between the different projection angles, so I'll lower this a little bit to sharpen the results, and then for the height influence, I'll go ahead and lower that down as well. And in this case, I'm going to leave the scale set to 1. If I go back to the PBR mode, it's a really, really subtle effect, but you can see it right here that there's some darker values and then some brighter values. And if I toggle the layer on and off, you can really see what it's doing. Again, it's a really subtle effect, but subtlety is key in making believable textures. So an effect like this will go a long way. Alright, now I want to add some little splotches of weathering and grime and things to that effect. So I'm going to add a new surface layer and just use the concrete floor surface right here. After assigning a quick name, I'll type in a hex value to change the albedo for a slightly lighter, more yellowish tinted color. And then I want to lower the wrap to underlying just a tiny bit, and I'll explain why I did that in a few minutes. Beyond that, the only thing I need to do for this layer is lower the scale of the texture quite a bit. There we go. And now I'm ready for a mask stack. So I'll click on this mask stack icon and I'll start off with a map component. And what the map component does is lets us either use a custom mask image that we've made, or I can use one of the Megascan surfaces. I can either choose layer map, which lets us use one of the surface layers already loaded into the scene, or I can choose library asset and then select a surface from my local library. For this mask, I'm going to go ahead and choose the library asset, and then I'll type pebbles into the search bar. And I'll select this beach pebbles round surface here. And so if I hit 9 and go back to the mask view again, you can see that since it's using the AO map of the surface currently, that the AO map of the surface is acting as my mask. And I can invert it and play with the range to get different results, which is really powerful. But in this case, I don't want to use the AO, and instead I'm going to change this to the displacement texture. Now you can see that the displacement texture is being used as my mask. So I'm going to play with some of the settings to tweak the results a little bit more. So what I'm going to do now is bring the lower range slider up a bit to around 0.66 or so, and then I'll just drag the upper one down a little bit. And as you can see, the darker gray pebbles dropped lower to the point of being black, while the brighter values got closer to white. And this gives the mask a bit more sparse and random look to it, which is what I'm going for. Now the mask details are a bit too large, so I'm going to add a projection modifier, and I'm going to select the box projection again. And I'll leave these settings alone up here, but I am going to drop the radius here a little bit, and my height influence I'm going to drop to 0. And for the scale, I want to nudge it up just ever so slightly. Alright, now I'm going to throw on another noise, but this time it's going to be a whirly too. Again, I'll play with the seed, amplitude, and frequency to find something I'm happy with, and then before long you'll notice how we have a really cool cellular-looking pattern. But as I start to adjust the octaves, lacunarity, and persistence, the noise really starts to take on a different look, feeling less and less procedural. With that finished, I'll invert the results and then multiply the component, which gives me a really cool chunky look to the mask below, which has completely repurposed the original pebble mask that I started with. So if I toggle the layer, you can really see how it's impacting the layers beneath. Alright, I'm going to add a gradient remap next, and the first thing I'm going to do is drop the repeat down to 0, and then adjust the range sliders, which kind of acts as if I'm adjusting the levels. So after adjusting the sliders a little bit, I'll drop the curve down a little bit as well to further refine the mask. Okay, now I'm going to add a normal component, and a normal component acts a lot like a position gradient, but it does take the world normals into account to determine how the mask falls off. So for this layer, I'm going to leave the angle at 0, but I am going to pull the tilt to the center so that it's coming entirely from above. And then I'll adjust the range, which again is like playing with the levels so that I can really tighten the transition. After that, I'll set the blend to multiply, which is going to keep the majority of the mask to be restricted to normals that are facing upwards. However, I don't want this to be exclusively the case, so I'll lower the component's opacity down so that we ease back in some of those details on the other parts of the model. Now I'm going to add another gradient remap, and I'm just going to pull down on the upper range slider a little bit. Then I'll bump the repeat up to 2, and then I'll set the blend to overlay to soften the impact of the modifier. Then lastly, I'll drop in another parlor noise and quickly set the seed to something I like. The rest of the settings are fine as they are, so now I'm going to go ahead and change the blend to distort. Distort will actually use the effects of the component to distort the rest of the mask, which is really powerful, but as you can see, it's pretty easy to overdo it, so it's best to keep the distort intensity pretty low. So I'm going to go ahead and set it to around 0.3. Alright, if I hit 1 to go back to PBR mode, you can see that we have some nice little chunky grunge details that we've added across the material, and this will help further the look of weathering and decay of the material. So if I go back to the surface settings and go to the wrap to underlying, the more I drop this setting, the stronger it wants to bump out. If I go into normal mode, then you can see as I change that slider, it's becoming less dependent on the underlying normals, and as a result, it is much sharper and more unnatural. There's plenty of times you won't want to rely on the underlying normals, but for this piece, I just wanted to nudge that down a tiny bit so that we get a little bit of an extra bump, but it's still relying almost exclusively on the normals underneath. Alright, now that we're finished here, we're ready to move on to some moss. For the moss, I'm going to do something a little unconventional here. And instead of using one of the many moss options we have inside the Megascans library, I want to show you how we can quickly repurpose a completely unrelated scan for that. So let's start by adding a new surface layer, and I'm going to go ahead and search for a plaster material. And I'll just grab this plaster wall right here. I'll call the layer Scattered Moss, and then the first thing I'll do is change the albedo value to something that's a little more mossy in color. Now back at the top, I can change how the layer will blend in. Normally it's opacity masked, but if I change it to be from above, you can see that the layer blends in as if it's coming from outside the model. However, if I change it to below, we'll see that it's coming more from the inside. And in this instance, I'll set it to be from below, and then I'll pump up the value enough that I get full coverage on the model. And again, with wrap to underlying, I'll pull back on the slider just a tiny amount to give it a bit of a pop once the mask is applied. I'll adjust the scale of the texture again as well to ensure that we have some nice crisp details. And then lastly, I'm going to go to the displacement channel of the layer and expand it so that I can lower the strength of the displacement a bit. This way, when we set up the mask for this, the edges won't be too overpowering because the displacement for this particular surface is quite intense. So having this kind of control over the scan surfaces is really great. All right, with the surface property set, I'm ready to add a mask stack, so I'm going to go ahead and drop in a map component again. However, instead of using a library asset option, I'm going to choose the layer map. By default, it selects the layer you're already on, but I do want to use this layer anyways, so I'm going to go ahead and leave that alone, and I'm also going to leave it set to albedo texture. I'll go back to the mask mode and start adjusting the range sliders a bit. I'll bring the two sliders in quite close to each other, which gives me a really cool base mask to start working with that already feels like some moss spread. I'll add a Gaussian blur modifier on top of this and reduce the strength so that we can get just a slight blur on those edges. Now I can use a gradient remap to further refine the mask. I'll play with the range a little bit and then I'll set the repeat to 2. And when I do that, you'll see that we have this really cool kind of border ring around most of the mask. And if I go back to PBR view, you can see that we're already getting some really cool, sharper looking mossy fall off here. And so by adding that extra repeat, we have this really nice effect. And then for the curve, I'm going to bump it up a bit here. Nothing too extreme though. And then if I set this to overlay and lower the opacity a bit, I think I've struck a pretty nice balance with the strong, pronounced border around the moss, yet it still feels fairly natural. And again, I was able to do this utilizing a surface that was never intended to be used as moss. It's a really cool way to repurpose the scan data from the Megascans library. Alright, we're ready for our next layer now, but instead of using a surface layer this time, I'm going to use a solid layer. I'll name the layer Miscoloration, and then I'll give it an albedo color of something a little more greenish yellow. I'm then going to pull back on the opacity a little bit so that some of the underlying layers start to show through. Okay, now I'm going to add a mask stack, and I'll kick things off with a normal component. Like before, I'm going to make sure that this is coming from above, and then I'll bring the range sliders together really tight. So if I go back into mask mode, you'll see that I have a very sharp edge here, so I'm going to want to soften that up a tad, and I'm going to do that by another Gaussian blur. And again, I'm going to keep the strength very, very low. Just a bit to keep the border from being razor sharp. I want to throw on another Perlin noise on top of that, and then as before, I'll change the various settings until I have a look I'm happy with. And then I'll set the blend mode to multiply. However, I don't want the mask to go full black, which removes the layer entirely, so I'll lower the opacity way down so that it acts more like some value changes in the layer rather than removing it altogether. So now we have some value breakup in the layer, but overall the upward faces have the green tint to help further sell the mossy growth on the gravestone. Okay, now I want to add even more layers of moss coloration and grime, so I'm going to add another solid layer here and call it moss overlay. I'll also give this layer a greenish tint for the albedo value, and then lower the opacity down to around 0.6 so that, again, it doesn't feel too overpowering. Next, I'll create a mask stack, and then the first thing I'm going to do is add a position gradient. I'll hop back to the mask view to better see what's going on, and I'm going to make sure that the tilt is set to 0 degrees. Now, I want this thing to come from below, so I can either change the setting to be from below, or I can keep it above and then simply invert the results. It's the same difference. Now I'm going to add another Whirly 2 noise, and as before, I'm going to play with the seed, amplitude, frequency, and so on to get the look I'm going for. And then I'm just going to set the results to invert, and then I'll set the blend mode to add. And now it's added on top of the position gradient below. So if we go back to PBR, you can see that we not only have some nice splotches of green across the model, but we also have a nice subtle green coming from below to give it more of the aged and weathered look that we're going for. Alright, this is looking pretty cool, so I just want to add a few finishing details, And the first thing I'm going to do is add another solid layer and call it Edge Highlights. And instead of changing the color of the albedo or anything like that, what I'm going to do is change the blend mode of the albedo from normal to add. And obviously this is a little too intense, so I'm going to drop the opacity down to around 0.35. So now we'll go into the mask stack and simply add a curvature component. If I hit 9, you can see what the curvature component is doing. And so as I start to play with the level settings a bit, I'll end up with some nice highlights on the edges across the model. When I go back to render mode, you can see that I have these nice yet subtle highlights going across the entire texture. Now I'm going to do a very similar process for some cavity detail. I'm going to use a solid layer and name it cavities. And then instead of using an add blend, I'll use multiply. And then I'll lower down the opacity as well. I'll add a new mask stack and then drop in a curvature component. But instead, this time I'm going to change the default curvature to cavities only. So if I go to the mask mode, you can see that only the cavities are being masked off. So I'll play with the level sliders a bit until I'm happy with how broad the mask is. And then if I hit 1 and toggle the layer, you can see what kind of impact it's having on the texture. If I hit 2 and go into albedo view, you can see the results even better and the kind of impact the layer is having, and how we quickly added some great depth to the texture with just a single mask component. And that should just about do it. As you can see, we were able to take a 3D asset from one biome and quickly give it a fresh new look as if it was created for a completely different biome, and it only took a handful of layers and masks. This process, which is simple yet very robust, allows you to custom fit any model to the theme of your choice. And since these layers were built with the procedural masks, you can simply swap out the asset for another, and you'll get the same results. This allows you to apply your custom-made mix to any asset so that you can fill out your environment in a hurry. Or if you want, you can even group the layers together and make a smart material so that you can quickly apply it to any mixer scene you have, so that you can then custom tailor the settings for each model you're texturing. The process is fast, powerful, and of course, user-friendly, which is one of the biggest points of focus for Mixer. I hope this tutorial was helpful for you, and we can't wait to see what you make. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.